If we go back to 1960, every one of the countries in the world with per capita incomes below $1,000 in modern currency was less than one-third urban. Today, more than 40% of those countries, of those poorest countries, are more than one-third urban. And we have the growth of vast cities like Kinshasa in places that are both poor and often poorly governed. This creates tremendous upside potential. These are places where economic prosperity can come, but also tremendous challenges, for there are demons that come with density, and there is no demon that is worse than contagious disease. Professor Bloom, Barry, can you tell us a little bit about the mismatch between the scope of the challenge of disease in the developing world and the level of resources that are available to meet that challenge?
It's a wonderful question. If one looks at the burden of disease in the world, that is the premature death and compromise in healthy life due to disabilities, and maps that around the world, 84% of the burden of disease occurs in low and middle income countries. If one at the same time looks at the resources being spent for health, 86% of the resources spent on health are in the OECD countries, and about 14% spent in low and middle income countries. That's a huge disparity in one of the many inequities or inequalities in the world that affects everything, including life expectancy.
How does this interact with urbanization? How do you see urbanization contributing to and perhaps ameliorating the downsides of all this poverty?
Almost quite the contrary. The major goal in an epidemic is, believe it or not, not the first priority to save lives. The first priority is to interrupt transmission to save more lives. And you do that in the rural areas, in very poor places, if you can engage the community. Much more difficult in Monrovia, in cities where there is significant distrust of governments, government edicts, along with a lot of other divisions and insularity and mythology, all spread out in this very complex context of a city.
So it's just very hard necessarily to track who's meeting with whom or who's connecting with whom. In some sense, cities allow more interactions, which is generally a good thing, but it also means more opportunities to spread plague as well, right?
It can be argued that the control of Ebola in the cities in West Africa did not come from organized government or overseas experts, but came from local people that took leadership in their communities and were trusted, as the government was not, to isolate patients or take them to hospitals.
And in some senses, what cities can mean is that non-governmental entity weakens and then gets replaced by these formal institutions. We all experience this around us every day, right? We don't rely on our neighbors for most services. We pay someone to do it, or we expect a professional medical team to fix it.
Again, taking the case of Liberia, but it's not terribly different in the other two countries, Sierra Leone and Guinea in West Africa. Before the outbreak of Ebola, for a country of 4.2 million people, there were 51 physicians. There were fewer than 1,000 trained nurses. So one has to think in a very sophisticated way of how do we organize healthcare in a country of very limited resources and very high risk for very serious diseases.
Does the fact that information is at least more available in cities provide an added edge to urban living in the developing world?
Depends on whether you trust the information. In Liberia, they did not. And the assumption was there are not always good motives when edicts are given to isolate people or change traditional burial practices. How can you trust those people if they haven't done anything for you in the past?
So the best outcome is clearly to move from governments that people don't trust and that are not effective to governments that people do trust and that are effective. And that's surely right.
So Rwanda has a GDP of about four times higher than Liberia. It's about $7 billion. And they have done a magnificent job in organizing health in that country. So it can be done with limited resources.
So one of the things that urbanists like to emphasize is the greater flow of information that can often occur within cities. The critical element, as well as having the package, is knowing about the package. Do we think that, in fact, knowledge about simple health solutions spreads more easily in cities in the developing world, or do we think lack of trust towards your neighbors, towards doctors, towards the government means that, in fact, cities, although wonderfully filled with human density, end up being informational deserts?
My response to the question is a fond hope that has not been realized, that the greatest medical invention in the last 100 years has been the cell phone. And the hope with the cell phone, there is, in the poorest countries in Africa, almost everybody has a cell phone. And the potential, even with SMS, of transmitting health messages, of finding out when the local dispensary is stocked out of drugs, has potentially changed the ability really to create a knowledgeable health system in the health professions, to the community health workers. What do you need? I can learn instantly what you need and then get it there a month or a week or a day in time. We never had that. We didn't have that communicability between people in villages and people in the countryside. My disappointment is we haven't really learned how to use that. And the network of the social networks are in many places more powerful than all the science that we have. People can be very distrustful of real data and real evidence. That's a big challenge. And the cell phone can be used and misused. And we haven't learned how to use it in the poorest countries in the most effective way.